This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
Howl, howl, howl! Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy. Welcome everybody to another edition of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio Superstation, founded by your friend, my friend, our friends, the man with a million friends, Mr. Bill Bragg. Mr. Steve Archiver Bannock is sitting here as well.
No, I'm not. I'm not sitting.
All right, you're squatting. He's practicing his squatter's rights.
I'm looking for this Fred Foy person that was just talking. I heard his voice, but I don't see him anywhere. Where did you hide him?
He's under the lid here in the mixer, you see.
Ooh. Is that safe for him to be in there?
Well, you know, let's not get into that, shall we? We got a really big show to bring you folks, and so we want to allow time to get both of these items in here. First item is a interview we did at the Friends of Old Time Radio Convention last year. An interview with none other than Bob Hastings, very big name. He was in old-time radio, also in TV and films. What did he do? He was in a lot of X-1s on radio, played Archie Andrews for a while, played on that show. He was also on TV, McHale's Navy, Captain Binghamton, Joe Flynn's right-hand man on that program.
He was Kelsey the bar owner on All in the Family.
Yes, he was, amongst many, many other
and
things.
He was in a soap opera, a daytime soap for 3, 4, 5 years.
He was
in
an
I can't remember which one.
An Ops opera. I'm sorry, that's the next interview. Sorry, that's John Rayburn. That's next time. So that's a little preview. John Rayburn interview next time on The Glowing Dive. But right now, our interview with Bob Hastings. So I think without further ado, we're going to get into that in just a sub-note. After that, we got a special program by request. Just got it in. Hearthstone of the Death Squad for Doris and Gerald Covey. So, folks, if you're listening, stay tuned for that one. But right now, without further ado, let's get into our interview here with Bob Hastings at the Friends of Old Time Radio Convention, Newark, New Jersey, in October of last year. Bob was nice enough to come on up to our room where we had little Glowing Dial Studios East set up there and gave us some of his time.
Yeah, he didn't mind the messy room either.
No, as a matter of fact, he was a really nice guy, and we thank him for his time. And here, without further ado, is that interview. We've got Bob Hastings sitting here with us, who has taken some time out of his busy schedule to sit down with us. And
busy schedule of doing nothing. It's very hard to fill this in.
We are here at the Friends of Old Time Radio Convention here in Newark, New Jersey. let's start the questioning, Bob. How did you get started in show business?
How did I get started? Well, actually, John, a teacher heard me sing in school.
Okay.
Singing at assembly. I even remember singing Home on the Range. Nobody ever went home since then. Well, but she heard me sing and decided that I should be on radio. This was about 1936. And her mother took me around, and I auditioned, and I started singing on Nick Kenny, WMCA. Nick Kenny had a Daily Mirror radio show. It's before your time, John.
Mm-hmm.
But Nick Kenny had a column in the Daily Mirror.
Okay.
And he had this show every Saturday morning for 1 hour. And I started as a kid singer there.
Cool.
That's the way it started, and here we are.
So that was your basically your first job in radio?
Yes, that was the first job, yes. And, no pay, but first job.
Well, that's a lot of people, you could call it an internship, couldn't you?
Sure, sure. And then from there, where I really started, I was there for a couple of years, and then I auditioned for Madge Tucker, Coast to Coast on a Bus. That was at NBC,
mm-hmm.
when there was not two networks, it was one network. NBC was WEAF and WJZ.
Okay.
And
yeah.
I started singing there and then started doing lines. She had a Saturday morning show called Our Barn, which is never as popular as Let's Pretend, but we did the same thing. We did
children's stories.
Children's mm-hmm. stories. And then I just started acting, and from there went into soap operas, and that was it.
Hmm. So, well, that was your transition from singing to acting.
Yes.
Did you go back to the singing at all?
Oh, yeah. I still sang on Coast to Coast on a Bus. That was every Sunday morning from 9 to 10. People mm-hmm. will remember the name Milton Cross. Milton Cross was the MC. And Madge Tucker wrote it, directed it, produced it, did everything. And we all learned. But we put in a lot of hours with these scripts. You know, mm-hmm. the Sunday morning show was all singing, but you had lines going up to it. We were on a bus, coast to coast on a bus, and we'd go, you know, say, oh, yeah, look at that. There's the Rocky Mountains, and somebody would sing a song about the mountains, mm-hmm. and that's what we did. For many years, I did that till I went into service in 1943.
Okay.
I did that, and then I did Pretty Kitty Kelly, Hilltop House, Nora Drake.
All soap operas.
Mm-hmm. All the soap operas, yeah.
Now, toward the end of the golden age of radio.
Yes, don't bring it up. I get so upset.
Well, no,
I love radio.
I shouldn't have said the word end because of this convention,
yeah,
because of
yeah.
Yesterday USA Radio, and many other reasons that it's alive and well.
Well, it's the best. I've enjoyed radio more than anything from a standpoint of I feel the best actors I worked with were radio actors.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you had to be an actor, John. Nobody
well, yes.
saw that you were 6 foot 8 or
something. Well,
you
can't just stand there and read a script
You had to be an actor, and people had to believe what you were doing.
As I think I heard Agnes Moorehead used to do her Sorry Wrong Number, or a lot
oh,
of
yes.
her, especially
yes.
that script.
Mm-hmm.
She did it so, I mean, she almost tore her hair out,
oh,
she,
yeah.
her clothes
yeah,
were
well,
all messed, and she collapsed on the table when she was done with it. You know,
that's a little overdramatic, but
makes for a great performance.
But
though.
you had to be able to act. I mean, nobody saw what you looked like. I mean, today looks, I mean, you look at some of the shows that you mm-hmm. watch, you can look at some soap operas and say, my gosh, how do these people, you know, get these jobs?
Yeah.
They learn on the job because they're beautiful and they're young and what have you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but that's television and that's movies.
That's right. Now, like I said, towards later in the 50s, you did some X-1.
Oh, I did a
which
lot
is
of
what
there.
I know you.
Yeah, after the war, there
one
was,
of the
it was Dimension X, X-1, which were kind of the same show.
But yeah.
I don't know where they changed the name, you know.
Well, the 1950, I think, was Dimension X. Then down the road
okay.
in 55 or so, they changed mm-hmm. to X-1. I think they did a lot of the same stories.
It was the same type of stuff. It was all outer space, kind of. But, I did a lot of those. I did a lot of Cavalcades. They were good shows, Cavalcade of America.
Mm-hmm.
They used to be an hour show. And that's a funny bit, considering it was radio, that we did it from a theater. And we had an orchestra,
mm-hmm.
and the men wore tuxedos,
okay.
and the women wore evening dresses.
Ah.
You know, so...
Formal attire, but you're also playing to an audience, too,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, so we had an audience.
So you're dressing for
the
them.
And they were doing it at the theater across from the Lambs Club. Oh, boy. The Velasco Theater.
Okay.
It's on 44th Street. See, you don't remember this. You're just a child.
Well, hey, I'm pushing 36 here, so...
Oh, my goodness. I'm twice your age. That's frightening.
Age is just a number, though, Bob.
So they tell me.
It's just a number. As long as you think young, you will be.
It's what they put on your gravestone, the numbers.
Now, you did, this is a nasty word here, of course, but you did go into television.
Oh, yeah. Oh, we did mention Archie Andrews, you know, which I did for 10 years.
Right.
You know, it's, I still do Archie here at these conventions at this old age. But I did that right after the war till it went off the air.
Can you still do an Archie impression?
Well, we do. Yeah, I guess so. I have a cold now, but hello, Jughead. This is Archie. Come over right away. It's a matter of life or death. Or something like that. Send money, folks. Yeah, I went into television. I'll tell you, kind of interesting, the first television I ever did was in 1939, experimental, at NBC with Madge Tucker on the third floor at NBC, the... what was it, Radio City? The what was it? The Radio City building? No, what was it? The
Radio City Music Hall?
No. Isn't that awful? The mind is gone. But anyhow, that's what we did, and we wore almost a grayish makeup. And you talk about hot.
Even hot before, and the lights, too,
even
right?
It was hotter than it was when we went into live, you know, doing TV.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but that was Madge Tucker again. That was the same group of young kids and what have you.
So the broadcast probably didn't go more than...
Oh, no. That was just experimental. They would just do it for their own, you know, to see who melted.
It wasn't until like 10 years later that TV really started to...
kill the kids. You know, if the kids die, we won't let the adults do it. If their lights kill them. But no, it was fun. Yeah, I did a lot of television. Live television was good, too.
Yeah.
You had to be a good actor to do live.
I respect the people that did that because I look at things like... Requiem for a Heavyweight, written by Rod Serling.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, doing all that live and not slipping up.
Yeah. Oh, and you look at, I was listening to somebody talk about, like, you do an hour TV show that takes 2 weeks or more, some of them. You know, and you think, my gosh, we did an hour show live. You did rehearse.
Exactly.
But then you you did it live. And that was always, you know, it's funny, I always think if I should look terribly old from doing live TV, because every time you did a live TV show, your career was on the line. I mean, if you did something really terrible, you know, you would, you're out of work.
The only place evident that I remember seeing a lot of mistakes that went out on the air was Dark Shadows. Do you remember that?
I remember the show, yeah, the soap opera. Yeah.
It was shot not live, but live on tape.
Yeah.
So, like, one take, and if Jonathan Frid screwed up his line, it went out on the air, and a lot of these survived.
And you got to remember, I think they did one every day.
Yeah.
Live, you know. So
learning a half-hour script
like
every day, so they're to be respected.
It isn't like you have
it's a lot of
8 hours of rehearsal or 10 hours of rehearsal.
Right.
You know, but live television was good. And then I went, when did I go to California? I went out to do a pilot for Paramount in 1960.
Mm-hmm.
And then I stayed, and I guess then did a lot of the, oh God, the, what do you call the old shows, and Green Acres. And
McHale's Navy, right?
Oh, McHale's Navy from 62 to 66, yeah. That was probably the most fun I've had was working with Joe Flynn, who played Captain Binghamton.
McHale.
Oh, he was wonderful. He was, to me, the best talent on the show.
Yeah. Now, he really wasn't, in actuality, he wasn't really as crabby.
No. Joe was a great guy. We were very close friends. I was lost him at an early age. He didn't hit 50.
I don't think
he died just before.
Young, yeah.
And Joe, it's so funny because, not that I look young, but Joe was like 5 months older than I was.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to say, stand close to me. I look so good at the same age as you. Because he got gray and he's... Good guy.
So are you still active? I mean, are you still...
Done anything on camera in a long time. I do some voiceovers, and I guess the most prominent one would be there's a cartoon series of Batman that's on every day, and I'm the voice of Commissioner Gordon.
Okay, all right.
So we just finished doing a bunch of new ones of those, and I don't know if we'll ever do any more, but I don't know how many we've done. I didn't do them all. Probably all in all, we've done over 100, maybe a little over 100, and I probably did about 70, 75.
Now, when you go in to read for these, like the Batman, do you just read a whole bunch of lines off and
well,
they
do
them
it
in?
Differently than the way we did, you know, radio. I mean, everybody has his own little almost booth and his own track.
Right.
So everybody's on a different track. I don't particularly like it. I liked radio where you're looking at the actor. Even though you're reading it, you still can, you know, get eye contact and say something. But no, we all, and most of them, you just sit down like I'm sitting here.
Mm-hmm.
And I like to stand up.
Do they show you the video while you're doing that?
No.
Okay.
They have I guess the director, Andrea Romano, she's wonderful, good director. This gal knows her stuff and knows how to treat actors and how to handle them and get the best out of them. But sometimes you don't do it with everybody. I mean, I was away at one time doing something else, and I came back and did my own part by myself.
Uh-huh.
You know, and there's nobody to talk to, nobody to work with. But that's all right, you know. They're very accommodating if you have something else to do.
Yeah.
It's fun. Good people. Boy, we've had some really good people on that show. And it's well done, mm-hmm. I think. I think even the animation of it is a pretty good class of animation.
Yeah, a friend of mine likes it, and he's my age. Uh-huh. So, I mean, it's not...
Well, I must say, John, I have 10 grandchildren. And I would say the little ones, it's a little frightening for them.
Yeah, I mean, some of the animation is not made for kids.
I mean there's some violence in it, and there's...
some of the sillier stuff, like Ren and Stimpy and things like that.
You know who's wonderful on that?
For an adult audience.
Is Mark Hamill, plays the Joker.
Okay, uh-huh.
And he's wonderful. He's good. A fellow who plays Batman is good. I just get a kick out of the Joker. We had Ronnie McDowell played the Scarecrow.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so
they're getting some major
people.
Voices
oh,
there
yes,
to do
oh, yes.
this.
Well, it's a good job. They pay you well, so
mm-hmm.
everybody's happy to do it.
That's good. Now, you've been... actually, before I ask you that, do you have any anecdotes? I like to ask this of folks that we interview, when you're especially in radio or maybe live TV where something may have gone wrong... And it was...
Yes. Well, there are, you know, any number of... The first one that comes to my mind, I used to do a show just before I went into service in 43 called The Adventures of the Sea Hound with Captain Silver and Jerry.
Mm-hmm.
And I played Jerry. And our announcer was Hugh Downs.
Okay.
And
mm-hmm.
a very fine actor, Juano Hernandez, played a villain for this sequence of maybe a month or 2 months.
Uh-huh.
And in those days, the announcer stood at a little thing against the wall, you know, and he pushed the button and said, you know, ABC presents The Adventures of the Sea Hound with Captain Silver and Jerry.
Mm-hmm.
And just as we went on the air, Juano Hernandez burped, and it just came, I mean, right. And Hugh Downs got through, you know, The Adventures of the Sea Hound and Jerry. And he opens the door and goes out into the control room, and you can hear him laughing. And he's got the opening narration.
Oh, boy.
And I have first line.
He's got to compose himself real quick.
So he doesn't. He doesn't come out. He's in there on hysterics like I can. So I had the first lines of the show after the narration as Jerry and going through the jungle and, you know, all upset. And I did the narration. I read the narration and said, you know, and we are in so, and, you know, just changed a couple of words.
Did you do it in character?
And I'm now running through the room and went into, and then they're all laughing in the control room. And when I got through, it's like, you know, I was about 18 years old. I mean, you don't do this. This is
That's
big
a good
business,
save, though, on your part,
you know?
Though, you know.
Oh, well, yeah.
You could have pretended
somebody else probably
to be the announcer
voice.
And
but then when I went into, and I'm looking at them, and I started to go, but I'm running through the jungle saying, Captain Silver, where are you? And it, you know, so it sounded like he was scared
to death.
Well,
to turn a laugh into a cry, do it right.
The cuff. That was kind of funny. It was another one that just slipped my mind. That was funny. You know, they did a thing once, not to me, but Jack Kelk, who was on Superman,
mm-hmm.
who played the kid, whatever his name is.
Jimmy Olsen. Yeah.
And on the air, Bud Collier starts undressing him while he's doing his lines. You know? The only other one was we used to, being a sustaining show, if anybody remembers what a sustaining show was.
No sponsor, yeah.
No sponsor and much less money. And they had me in my character doing a promo, and it was for the United States Crop Corps. And we had an actor, Walter Vaughn, whose son is Robert Vaughn. But Walter was the funniest guy. I mean, he played Tex. So I have to do this. And before we went on air, he says, remember, say crop. Whatever you do, say crop. You know, and I'll be there if you have a problem. He stood right beside me at the mic, and I'm doing, join the United States Crop Corps. And you know, John, you get those. Did I say it right?
Yeah.
And I had to say it three or four times, but I got through it. But he was there, you know.
spoonerisms do happen. And,
oh, yes.
Some of them
yeah.
are rather embarrassing. So. Yeah.
Oh, I can think of some which I can't tell. But,
well, it's a family channel here, so leave those out. But.
I remember once on Captain Silver, the captain had a line, "I've got the bull by the horns." And he didn't say horns, and he swore after it. And we said, "Do you know what you said?" And he said, "No, I said bull by the horns." He said, "I know you didn't." And that was it. You know. What else can I do for you, John? I mean, you pay me so much money here. I mean, I really can't just, you know, go on like
I'll
this.
I'll double
I mean,
the pay.
Whatever.
What, you know,
hey, wasn't there a show called that, Double or Nothing?
Yes. How often have you been coming to the conventions like this?
I guess I've been coming to this one probably 7 or 8 years, and I missed one. I was busy at the time doing a show, but they keep inviting me back till I get something right, you know. And I enjoy it. I am a New Yorker. I live on the coast now.
Okay.
But I'm from Brooklyn, New York, and I come back, and it's great. They bring me back, and then when my mom and dad were alive, I would visit them. I still have a brother here who's on As the World Turns for those old ladies who watch soap operas. He's been Dr. Bob Hughes for about 35 years.
Okay.
And then I visit my wife, has three sisters, so I get a trip to New York, and I enjoy it. And I enjoy the people. I mean, this is like finding out people do remember you. And I'll tell you, there are people here who tell me of shows I did, and I tell them I never did that show.
You just don't remember.
I never did it.
I can't show
you. And then
you
they
any...
send me a tape. And at the
yeah.
end, it's me. Uh-huh. And I know it's me when I hear it. But who can remember?
Well, when you're an actor, especially like you, with the large body of work that you have done, mm-hmm. I don't think there's anybody that can remember every exact syllable of every script they've ever
done. Oh, I don't even remember.
Done, you know.
I don't remember theme songs from the soaps I did. I don't remember. Somebody will say, "Oh, that was such a fine show. Don't you remember that one in 1948 or 49?
Yeah.
I don't know. You do them and you erase them and you go on to the next show.
Mm-hmm.
But it was fun. Soap operas were fun. And then I did 8 years on General Hospital.
Okay.
With Luke and Laura. I was there during that.
During that big phase.
Somebody told well, I know that they used to have some colleges had a course in whatever they called it, I don't know, but they used to listen to
Luke and Laura 101 or
General Hospital and maybe critique it or something. But that's what's happened to the world I live in, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
Well, that's about all I think we had to add. I think we've
covered
quite a bit.
Brought
here.
Me up here to the top of the Empire State Building to do this. Just fantastic. Well, it was nice.
Only kidding. We're on the fourth floor of the Holiday Inn North. Sorry.
It was nice chatting, and I thank you for wanting to talk to me. It brings back wonderful memories to me. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Bob, for your time.
Hey, John and Steve here, and the Buggles are right. But we know of a place where the radio stars are alive in all their glory. And Bill Bragg, where is that place?
The Glowing Dial.
That's right. And Frank Brzee will tell you that it's...
heard exclusively on Yesterday USA Radio.
The Glowing Dial features the widest variety of old-time radio shows found anywhere. Shows like...
The Jack Benny Program.
Suspense.
Quiet, please.
The Mercury Theater on the air.
You'll also hear interviews with the stars of old-time radio. People like
Bob Hastings,
Leonard Maltin,
singer Betty Johnson,
Arthur Anderson,
Fred Foy,
Frank Brzee,
Bill Bragg.
The stars just love the Glowing Dial. Bob Hastings says,
"Don't miss it, it's fun."
And Arthur Anderson says,
"Oh, you like the Glowing Dial. It's magically nostalgic."
The Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve, heard only on Yesterday USA Radio.
Consult your YUSA program guide for airtimes.
Hi, I'm singer Betty Johnson, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts Big John and Steve here on Yesterday USA.
Well, there we go. Thank you, Betty Johnson, for that wonderful ID spot. Hope you enjoyed our interview with Bob Hastings there, and that little thing you heard afterwards was one of my things that broadcast school has taught me to do. Did that actually as a graded project, got an A on it, and a little show promo for The Glowing Dial and YUSA. And any comment on that, Steve? I don't know if you heard that before, have you?
Yes, I did, and I thought it was very good.
Well, actually, I had a part in it, too, because you heard my voice in there, too.
You heard a lot of voices in there. You heard Bill Bragg, you heard Bob Hastings, you heard everybody in there.
What a superb editing job you did on those, too.
Well, what can I tell you? A copy of that is on its way. Probably has reached Bill Bragg by now, and he told me that he will be playing that on the Sunday live show and on his nightly live shows as well. And I said, use it as often as you want, and so there you are. And on to our next program, which is a special request.
Yes.
I'll let you take that over.
By special request from Gerald and Doris Covey.
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 Yes.
They're in Washington.
Creston, Washington,
Creston,
I believe.
Creston, yes. Creston, Washington. I have to look that one up.
Better than Colgate, Washington, isn't it?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yes, that was a peak.
I wonder if they're tartar free. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Yes. Yes, from Creston, Washington, request from Doris and Gerald Covey. They wrote to us and asked for, three different programs, and we did find one of the shows that they had asked for called Hearthstone of the Death Squad.
Actually, I think we have found two of them. We only have one right now. I think they also asked for Count of Monte Cristo.
Yes, I'm only counting
which,
what we have in the hand.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
A couple of those are on their way, though.
Yes, we will be getting those shortly, hopefully. Anyway, Hearthstone of the Death Squad ran on CBS from 1951 to 52. It was only on for 1 year. This particular installment is called Terrifying Letter Murder,
mm-hmm.
and it was 1952. I don't have an exact date.
Yeah, we don't. Sorry about that, but at least this is...
it is a rare program.
There's only three available, I believe, according to Jay Hickerson's ultimate guide to circulating programs there. Only three programs are... in circulation, and I believe before long we will have all three of those. So there. Anyway, Stephen, if you'd like to reach over...
Box of Grito in oh.
Would you reach over to our friend the McGee Machine and
yes.
Start twiddling the dials and... Oh, there it is again. See, it's so quick. I pre-warm it up every day, actually.
Twiddle. It's better than twiddling your thumbs.
Yes, yeah, so sit back, folks. Close your eyes. And remember, Hearthstone of the Death Squad from 1952, and we'll be back to give you our address and say goodbye.
Hearthstone of the Death Squad in the Terrifying Letter Murder Case. Tonight, we again present the famous Hearthstone of the Death Squad, implacable manhunter of the Metropolitan Police, in one of his greatest investigations entitled The Terrifying Letter Murder Case, with Ethel Wilson as Lizzie Ackers and James Meehan as Jonas Caswell. And now, Inspector Hearthstone in the Terrifying Letter Murder Case. The scene opens in a large office building as a strange-looking man stops before a door marked Jesse Caswell, Public Stenographer. The man opens the door, and we hear him saying...
You Jesse Caswell?
Yes, I'm Miss Caswell.
I got something I want you to type for me.
I'm sorry, but it's after 8 and I can't accept any work tonight.
Listen, Miss Caswell, how much do you usually get for typing out just a few lines?
Well, 50 cents is my minimum charge, but I don't see...
Well, suppose I put this $50 bill on your desk and said it's yours, ma'am, for doing this little job.
$50? Well, that's a different thing. I'll put a piece of paper in my typewriter. All right. What is it you want me to type?
Start it off, to whom it may concern.
Go on. What next?
I've grown tired of life, and I've decided to end it all tonight. I hope my friends will understand and forgive.
I'll not type that kind of thing. I won't.
Do you see this gun, lady? You type what I say or else. Type it.
Don't point that revolver at me.
Type what I told you. Get going. And quit your squawking or I'll slap you in the mouth.
Here it is.
I'm not touching that letter. Put it on the desk.
But
Now sign your name to it.
No, no.
Here's a pen. Sign it, and you won't get hurt.
What is this? What are you trying to do? I've signed it.
Now stay where you are.
Take that gun away. Oh, thank heaven you've come. Help me.
You. What are you doing here? No. No, don't kill me. Don't. Don't.
What? You're going to kill me, too. No. No, no.
And 30 minutes later, we see Inspector Hearthstone of the Death Squad on the murder scene with his assistant, Detective Sam Cook, as the hysterical scrub woman who found the two bodies is saying...
No, Inspector Hearthstone, I didn't hear no shots. I was on another floor cleaning.
You say your name is Lizzie Ackers?
Yes, sir. I saw the lights on in Miss Caswell's office, so I opened the door. And I saw them two bodies. It's terrible, sir. His hair makes me sick.
I understand, Lizzie. I'll go into the next room for a while. We'll talk to you later.
I'll be right in here.
Close the door, Sam.
Okay. Why'd you stop questioning her so suddenly, Inspector?
Because I think the silent evidence of these two dead bodies is more important at the moment.
Looks like the woman killed herself after writing a suicide note. See the gun? Still in her hand.
The woman didn't kill herself, Sam. She was murdered. That's a phony suicide note. And that gun was put in her hand after the killing.
You mean this dead man killed her?
Now, how could a dead man murder her, Sam? What happened is that both these people were murdered by a third person. The question is, who? It's a fantastic situation.
You don't think that scrub woman, Lizzie Ackers, could have done it, do you?
Get her back in here, Sam.
Come in, Lizzie.
Yes, sir.
Lizzie, are you certain you didn't hear any shots?
I told you before I didn't, Inspector.
Oh, sorry, Lizzie, I forgot. What I meant was, did you see anyone leaving this office before you found the bodies?
If I had, I'd have told you. Say, I don't like the way you're sizing me up. If you're getting any idea about me, are you forgetting I called the cops myself?
Tell me, what do you know about this dead woman?
All I know is that her name is Jessie Caswell, and that she was a public stenographer, with all kinds of people coming in and out of her office.
And the sign on the door tells us that much.
Well, you asked me, didn't you?
Ever hear her quarreling with anyone?
I never heard Jessie Caswell fighting with no one. Only thing was...
Yes?
She told me some nut was trying to get money out of her by claiming she was one of them missing heirs to a big fortune. Like you read about in the papers, Inspector Hearthstone. But I never seen him or heard his name.
Missing heir. Sam, turn that murdered man's body over.
There you are, Inspector.
Now, Lizzie, look at this murdered man's face carefully. You know him?
No, I don't know him from Adam.
That's odd.
What you getting at now?
His name is Adam Ackers. A known trigger man, just out from a 10-year stretch in prison. And your name is Lizzie Ackers. What's the connection? Quick, tell me.
Oh, he's my own stepson. But I swear I ain't seen him since before he went to prison. And I never had nothing to do with him before then, either.
That's another one for the Marines, Inspector Hearthstone. Come along with me, Lizzie.
Yes, she may be telling the truth, Sam. Go and get on with your work, Lizzie.
I wouldn't have thought this of any cop, Inspector, believing a poor woman like me.
Protecting the poor is the duty of the police, Lizzie. Get along now.
Yes, Inspector.
Sam, get headquarters on the phone while I go through this desk drawer.
Hello, Smith. Inspector Hearthstone wants to talk to you.
Hello, Smith. Phone every radio station at once.
Right, Inspector.
Have them announce that a pretty blonde woman, about 35, named Jessie Caswell, public stenographer, believed to be the heiress of long-dead Ezekiel Caswell, Canadian copper mine king, was found murdered in her office along with Adam Ackers, notorious gang killer, tonight.
I've got it down, Inspector Hearthstone. What else?
Ask any relative or acquaintance of the murdered woman to communicate immediately with Hearthstone of the Death Squad.
That all?
Send a detail of men to Jessie Caswell's apartment to search for any letters or papers relating to the murder. Owen Smith.
Yes, Inspector Hearthstone?
Get a complete file together of the murdered woman's past life. Thank you. Goodbye.
What a fiend you got for remembering things, Inspector. You knew straight off that dame was a missing heiress to all the copper mines in the world.
No, not at all, Sam. I found a carbon of a letter she wrote to a lawyer in her desk drawer. A man named Fielding.
What do you know?
Jesse foolishly thought the lawyer Fielding was trying to take her in when he wrote he believed she was the Caswell heiress. Fact is, Fielding is a top man in his profession.
Shall I look up his address, Inspector?
I know his address, Sam, and it's not far from here. Come along.
What about the scrub woman, Lizzie?
I haven't marked her off my list yet.
Why, Inspector Hearthstone, come in. It's nice to see you.
And to see you, Mr. Fielding. Oh, what brought Detective Cook and me, Fielding, is an amazing murder. A pretty blonde woman named Jessie Caswell.
Yes, I just heard a news flash on the radio. She was a queer character.
We found a carbon copy of a letter to you in her desk.
You know, Inspector Hearthstone, I'm certain that woman is the heiress to the Ezekiel Caswell fortune. But when I sent one of my men to see her about it, she practically threw him out of the office. Said we were trying to play some sort of phony missing heiress game to get money out of her.
When you were really trying to put a great fortune in her hands.
Exactly. Then I wrote her and she accused me of being a confidence swindler. I guess that's the copy of her letter to me that you found.
How positive are you, Fielding, that Jessie Caswell was the heiress to that big fortune?
Just about 99%. One of the soundest legal firms in Canada sent the case to me. Old Ezekiel Caswell died about 25 years ago. He was 80 years old then.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in all these years, nobody has turned up to claim the estate. So the time came to do something.
Did they advertise in the American papers for the missing heirs?
Yes, but with no results. That's when they engaged my help. And as I said, we concluded Jessie was the missing heiress. But she'd have no part of us.
Well, I guess that's all I need now, Fielding.
I wish I could help you more, Inspector.
You supplied me with a magnificent motive for Jessie Caswell's murder. That is, if I can find the murderer. And in this case, it's not easy. Well, Sam, let's run along. Good night, Fielding.
Good night, Inspector.
If you don't mind my cutting in, Mr. Fielding.
Not at all, Detective Cook.
I'm wondering why you didn't ask the Inspector how Jessie Caswell was murdered.
Why,
it may be because Mr. Fielding is devoid of curiosity, Sam. Good night again, Fielding.
Good night.
Hope I didn't put my foot in, Inspector Hearthstone, but it just ain't natural for a guy not to ask how somebody was bumped off, unless he already knows.
Fielding is a man of good reputation, Sam.
So were plenty of others who got the chair, Inspector.
Let's get back to headquarters. Our radio appeal may have brought results.
Inspector, you're on the beam.
Yes?
There are two parties waiting outside asking for you. Say they got all the answers about the murdered public stenographer, Jessie Caswell.
Ask them in, Sam.
Come in, Mr. Barnes.
I am Angus Barnes, Inspector Hearthstone. Meet my wife, Sarah Caswell Barnes.
Sarah Caswell Barnes?
Caswell was her maiden name, Inspector.
We just flew in from Canada, Inspector, and we heard your radio call by accident at the airport terminal.
You've got the wrong slant on that murdered woman. Jessie Caswell is not old Ezekiel Caswell's heiress.
Well, what makes you so sure of that, Mr. Barnes?
Because my wife Sarah here is the heiress. She is Ezekiel Caswell's granddaughter.
Then why didn't you claim the fortune before this?
Because we didn't know there was one, Inspector.
The first we heard of it was a week ago, Inspector Hearthstone. A friend in Canada told us he'd seen an ad in the newspaper looking for Grandfather Ezekiel's heirs.
So we hustled on to New York right away to find out about it. The lady, the public stenographer who was murdered, was only the old man's niece.
And your wife, being the granddaughter, would naturally be the real heiress. First in line.
That's it. Just to make sure of things, I brought my birth certificate with me. Here it is, Inspector. I was born in Ottawa, Canada, 1921.
Strange that Canadians would come to New York to claim the fortune of the Canadian-born Ezekiel Caswell.
What? Well, we thought this the place to come.
May I have your birth certificate for a few days, Mrs. Barnes?
Oh, couldn't you take a picture of it instead, Inspector? I don't like to leave it out of my hands. My mother always kept it in the family Bible.
Sam, here's an order. Have this birth certificate photographed and return the original to Mrs. Barnes.
Okay, Chief.
If that birth certificate is legitimate, Mr. Barnes, your wife probably is the heiress to a great copper fortune. Since Jessie Caswell is dead.
What do you mean by that, Inspector Hearthstone?
I mean you and your wife have a motive for murder.
Moody for mercy.
And I mean, too, I have no proof you two just arrived here from Canada by plane.
But we did.
Of course we did.
We'll have you completely checked, Mr. and Mrs. Barnes. I'll tell you frankly, your story doesn't ring true.
There's your birth certificate, Mrs. Barnes.
Oh, give it to me, not her, Detective Cook.
Sam, please have Mr. and Mrs. Barnes taken to the Elton Hotel and made comfortable there.
Listen here, you can't arrest us.
You can't do this to us.
I'm merely detaining you. Good night.
Come on, Mr. and Mrs. Barnes. I'll have Officer Smith take him over, Inspector.
Hello, operator. Give me Officer Smith, quick. Smith, Detective Sam Cook is turning a couple named Barnes over to you. When you get them outside, have the boys snap a few good pictures of them and send them to the chief of police at Ottawa, Canada.
The Barnes are on their way, Inspector. What's the idea of taking pictures of the birth certificate and holding Barnes and his wife?
One of the signatures on Sarah Barnes' birth certificate was written with green ink.
Oh, the same color Jesse Caswell's phony suicide note was signed with.
And the same color, Sam, that was in the murdered gangster's fountain pen when he was shot to death beside Jesse Caswell.
Wow, I guess that's beginning to tie things together nice.
Come in.
Telegram for Inspector Hearthstone.
Thanks. To Inspector Hearthstone of the Death Squad, regarding a radio broadcast for relatives or friends of murdered Jesse Caswell. I am dead woman's brother. Arrive your office tomorrow a.m. Signed, Jonas Caswell.
Your brother? Where does it come from, Inspector?
Montreal, Canada, Sam, and I have an idea it will give us the line that leads to our killer.
Hearthstone of the Death Squad and the terrifying letter murder case continues in just a moment. America is really strong for CBS Radio's two-hour parade of music every Friday night on most of these same stations. Hits from the big shows, music from vaudeville's best days, Tin Pan Alley's best numbers, new and old. That's what you have waiting for you tomorrow night. The orchestras of Alfredo Antonini, Ray Block, and Paul Weston play the tunes. Earl Wrightson, Jimmy Carroll, and Georgie Price head three great singing casts. Robert Q. Lewis throws open his waxworks, all bringing you two solid hours of pleasure tomorrow night on CBS Radio. Don't miss a minute. And now, back to Hearthstone of the Death Squad and the terrifying letter murder case. Inspector Hearthstone's investigation of the incredible double murder of Jesse Caswell, public stenographer, and Adam Acker's gangster in her office, has revealed this. Jesse was apparently heiress to the vast mining fortune left by her uncle in Canada. But Sarah Barnes and her husband appear in Hearthstone's office declaring Sarah is the heiress, which makes them highly suspect. Just as Inspector Hearthstone ordered the Barnes held, he received a wire stating that the murdered woman has a brother, Jonas, and he is coming to see Hearthstone. It is now the following morning, and while awaiting Jonas Caswell's arrival, the inspector is called on one of the greatest sources of information known to the police, a stool pigeon. Detective Sam Cook is ushering one in now, saying,
"Here's Bozo Sparks, Inspector."
Morning, Bozo. I suppose Detective Cook told you what I wanted to see you about?
Yeah, sure, about Jesse Caswell's murder.
Got any ideas, Bozo, on how Adam Ackers, the trigger man, got into her office and was killed beside her?
Funny, ain't it? After bumping so many off himself with so much ahead, Ackie got himself bumped off her.
Well, somebody paid him to put the heat on Jesse Caswell, to make her type and sign a suicide note in her office. And then that person killed him to eliminate all evidence.
Well, I'm not saying I know anything personal, Inspector Hearthstone, but the grapevine talk is,
Get on with it, Bozo. Remember, the only reason you're walking the streets free is that you're useful to us.
Okay, okay. Well, as I was saying, the talk is some guy from Canada offered Ackers $5,000 to bump off the Jesse Caswell dame, forgetting his price for a trigger job was only $100. And Ackie naturally took the guy up.
What was the Canadian man's name, Bozo?
If it was a choice between telling you and the chair, Inspector, I couldn't answer that. I don't know.
Thank you, Bozo. That'll be all.
I'll be seeing you, Inspector. Why?
Well, it wasn't much, Sam, but it helps. And Hearthstone speaking. All right, send the man in. Sam, the murdered woman's brother is here. Let him in.
Okay, this way, mister. I'm Detective Cook.
I'd like to see Inspector Hearthstone, please.
I am Inspector Hearthstone, and you're Jonas Caswell.
How do you do, Inspector?
How do you do?
You got my wire? Who killed my sister, Jessie?
Well, we're not quite ready to make an arrest yet, Mr. Caswell.
We got a couple of pretty hot suspects.
That's encouraging, Detective Cook. Thing I can't understand is why anybody would want to murder Jessie. She was just a public stenographer. Why would they want to kill her?
The enormous Ezekiel Caswell fortune. Why else? Jessie was the heiress, wasn't she?
My sister Jessie wasn't heiress to anything, Inspector Hostel.
What's that?
Our uncle, old Ezekiel Caswell, died years ago. I always understood he'd left most of his great copper fortune to a lot of charities.
When did you last see your murdered sister, Mr. Caswell?
Matter of 10 years, I'd say. Back when she left Canada and came to New York to open up a public stenographer's office. But take my word for it, she was no heiress, Inspector.
You're her brother and ought to know. I suppose you want to claim your sister's body.
Yes. That's why I really came here. Would it be asking too much if Detective Cook helped me make arrangements? I don't know too much about New York.
Oh, gladly, Mr. Caswell.
Well done, me, sir.
Oh, before you leave, Mr. Caswell, you asked who killed your sister.
I understand you're not sure yet.
We have a man and wife under arrest this minute.
What?
Mr. and Mrs. Angus Barnes. The wife, Sarah, claims she's the granddaughter of Ezekiel Caswell and heiress to his millions.
Angus Barnes and Sarah Barnes? Oh, that's ridiculous. They're imposters. They have to be.
People like that often turn up, Mr. Caswell, when the lure of a missing heiress to a fabulous fortune is broadcast. Oh, glad to have met you. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Inspector. Detective Cook. Remember, I'll depend on you, as you promised.
Well, Inspector, I guess he's got something about Barnes and his wife being imposters. The Ottawa police just reported that their whole story, including that birth certificate, looks strictly phony so far.
Sam, our next move is to get back to our first suspect in this case.
You mean that scrub woman, Lizzie Ackers? The stepmother of the gangster was killed along with Jesse Caswell?
This report from Officer Smith reveals definitely that far from not seeing her gangster stepson, Adam Ackers, for years, he was actually seen walking up to that same office building with Lizzie every night. We'll hop into the car and go and talk to Lizzie now. Don't tell me again you weren't lying, Lizzie.
Well, suppose my stepson, Adam Ackers, was walking into the office building with me. What difference does that make, Inspector?
You are going to tell me the truth or be jailed this minute.
Oh, if I didn't tell you everything, it was because I was scared. Oh, what do you want to know, Inspector Hearthstone?
I want a description of the man or woman who paid your stepson $5,000 to force the murdered Jessie Caswell to type a suicide note just before she was killed. And you are going to tell me.
All right, Inspector. I'll tell you.
Now, with all his evidence assembled, Inspector Hearthstone is ready to close in on the murderer of Jessie Caswell, a pretty blonde public stenographer and missing heiress, and the trigger man, Adam Ackers. The scene is police headquarters, and we hear Inspector Hearthstone saying to Detective Sam Cook,
"Now, Sam, watch this."
"Right, Inspector."
"Take this folder. It contains the death chair evidence we wanted."
"Yes, sir."
"And hand me each piece instantly I ask you for it."
"Gotcha."
"You've got all these people outside?"
"Every suspect, Inspector. Each one in a separate room."
"Good. Bring in Angus Barnes and his wife, Sarah."
"Mr. and Mrs. Barnes, come in."
"What do you want with us, Inspector Hearthstone?"
"Yes, what?"
"You'll soon find out. Our first police report from Ottawa, Canada, implied you were both imposters. Then we sent your pictures there."
Our pictures?"
"Sam, bring in Mr. Jonas Caswell."
"Jonas Caswell, come in now."
"What's that? Jonas Caswell? Well, whoever said we were imposters lied."
"Slow down, Mrs. Barnes. Here's Jonas Caswell, Inspector."
"You? Angus and Sarah here? I thought you were dead."
"You thought they were dead, Jonas?"
"That's why I told you anybody claiming to be Angus and Sarah Barnes were imposters, Inspector. They were supposed to be lost at sea. And good riddance.
Then you think, Jonas, that they killed your sister, Jessie Caswell?
You're a better judge of that than I, Inspector.
Why, you...
Quiet, Angus. Now, Jonas, why do you say the death of these two people, Angus and Sarah Barnes, would have been a good riddance?
Look up their record in Canada, Inspector. One dirty business after another. Terrible reputation.
You're a liar.
Quiet, Mrs. Barnes. Now, Sam...
Yeah, Inspector.
Give me the second police report from Ottawa on Angus and Sarah Barnes.
Hey, yes, sir.
It shows both you, Angus, and you, Sarah, to be people of uncertain character.
Then the cops in Ottawa are liars.
Sure, they're liars. Give me that report.
This is the last time I'll tell you and your wife to shut up, Barnes.
Now give me that letter found in the murdered woman's flat. Thanks, Sam.
That's the letter Jonas Caswell sent his sister, right, Inspector?
Jonas, this letter advises your sister, Jessie, that a man named Fielding, a lawyer, who approached her about being the heiress of Ezekiel Caswell's fortune, was trying to take advantage of her. In short, to stay clear of him.
That's correct. Fielding was trying to swindle her. My sister Jessie was only a public stenographer. She wasn't any too smart.
No proper protection for a brother to give his sister, Jonas. But now, Sam, bring in the office scrubwoman, Lizzie Ackers.
Who's she, Inspector?
One moment, please, Jonas.
You want me now, Inspector?
Lizzie, there are two men in this room. Look at them carefully.
I am.
Was this man, Angus Barnes, the one who paid your trigger man stepson $5,000 to force a suicide note from the public stenographer, Jessie Caswell, before she was murdered?
No, Inspector, I told you that before. It's this guy over here.
Ah, I wanted to be sure, Lizzie. Well, Jonas?
Know what, Hearthstone? You're more clever than I gave you credit for.
Hands up, Jonas Caswell.
Don't be dramatic, Detective Cook. I know the game is up. Yes, I killed my sister, Jessie. Took a plane from Montreal, did the job, flew back, and then wired you, Hostel.
Telling you, Inspector, this guy's the coolest murderer we ever took in.
When a $50 million fortune is at stake, you've got to be cool.
The electric chair isn't, Jonas Caswell. I arrest you for the murder of your sister, Jessie Caswell. And I'll give you credit for supplying me with one of the nastiest murders in my career. Take him, Sam, and charge him.
Who gets the $50 million, Inspector? Old Ezekiel Caswell's fortune.
Well, that's not our affair, Sam. But poor Jessie Caswell was never the missing heiress. She was murdered because her brother mistakenly thought she was.
Right again, Hearthstone. My mistake. I wanted to get the fortune instead of letting my sister get it. I, as nephew, was next in line. I didn't know Sarah Barnes, the old man's granddaughter here, was still alive. Ha! So she gets the money. Would have gotten it whether I killed Jessie or not.
Yes. It looks like Sarah Caswell Barnes gets the fortune whether she deserves it or not. And you, Jonas, get the electric chair.
And thus, Hearthstone of the Death Squad, right solved in the files of the terrifying letter, murder case. The part of Inspector Hearthstone was played by Alfred Shirley, written by Frank Hummert, directed by Henry Howard, and is a presentation of CBS Radio. Here is a special announcement. Beginning this coming Sunday, Hearthstone of the Death Squad will be heard every Sunday at 5:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Listen this Sunday for Hearthstone of the Death Squad in The Fabulous Engagement Ring Murder.
It, folks. No time even to give you the address. Be sure to listen to Bill Bragg's tape number one for our complete mailing address and how to get in touch with us. Until next time, this is Big John and Steve Archive for Banning.
Yep.
Saying thanks for listening. Keep positive thought. Keep looking up, and we will see you on the radio. Bye-bye.